Welcome to Studio CF, the video law blog of Carlton Fields. My name is Allison Kirkwood, and I'm a business litigator at the firm. Joining me today is Matt Leash, who's also a business litigator at the firm. The topic of this episode is trademark issues in internet keyword advertising. Matt, what is keyword advertising?
Keyword advertising is a very common form of internet advertising in which a company will pay a search engine such as Google or Bing for the right to have its advertisement or a link to its website appear when a particular search term is entered by the user. So for example, an auto repair company might pay Google for the right to have its link appear whenever someone types in the phrase oil change or transmission.
So how can a consumer tell which search results are actually paid advertisements?
Generally, the advertisements are displayed separately from the main search results. So a consumer will see the main list of search results generated by the search engine's algorithm, and then either above or to the side will be a separate set of results labeled sponsored links.
How widespread is the practice of keyword advertising?
It's very widespread, and it's a major source of revenue for all of the search engines. And just to give an idea of the scale, in 2007 alone, Google is reported to have taken in over $16 billion in revenue from its AdWords advertising program.
So what does this have to do with trademark law?
Trademark issues may arise when a business pays a search engine to have its link appear when a competitor's trademark is entered as a search term. So for example, a small soft drink company might pay Google for the right to have its advertisement appear whenever the consumer types in the name of a major soft drink company. And in fact, this is a very common practice.
So is the use of a trademark in keyword advertising a trademark violation?
The best answer right now seems to be maybe. There are really two distinct questions in assessing whether a trademark violation has occurred. The first is whether there's been a use in commerce for trademark purposes, and the second is whether there's a likelihood of consumer confusion.
Let's take those questions one at a time. First, how have courts treated the use in commerce question?
Until recently, the federal courts were split on this issue. The majority view was that purchasing a trademark as a keyword is a use in commerce for purposes of the Lanham Act. However, there were some district courts in the Second Circuit Court of Appeals that had held that this was not a use in commerce because the trademark did not actually appear in the advertisement or the sponsored link. It was purely an internal use. The split was resolved in 2009 in a case called Rescue.com versus Google, where the Second Circuit joined the majority view and held that purchasing a trademark as a keyword is a use in commerce for Lanham Act purposes.
What about the likelihood of confusion question?
Well, that remains less clear. That's a quintessentially factual determination, and because very few of these cases have actually gone to trial, there's not a lot of evidence of how courts will decide that issue. And the few courts that have addressed it have been split. In some cases, the outcome is turned on whether the trademark in question has actually appeared in the text of the sponsored link or not. And that makes sense, because if a consumer types in, say, the phrase brand X, and then is taken to a link that contains the phrase brand X, he or she is more likely to be confused than if the link does not contain that phrase. Courts have also split on whether to apply a doctrine called initial interest confusion, in which a trademark violation can be found when a consumer is initially confused into visiting a competitor's website, even if that confusion no longer exists by the time an actual purchasing decision is made.
Is there a prevailing view on the likelihood of confusion question at this point?
That issue is still in flux, but in a recent case, the Ninth Circuit issued a decision that may help bring some clarity to that area of law. And in that case, the Ninth Circuit found no likelihood of confusion where a company called ActiveBatch sued a competitor who had paid search engines for the right to have its links appear whenever the term ActiveBatch was entered. The court held that a sophisticated consumer of business software is likely to understand the mechanics of how search engines work and is likely to understand the difference between a sponsored link and a regular search result. So this still leaves room for a court to find likelihood of confusion based on the particular facts of a specific case. However, it does suggest that courts will not simply presume that consumers don't understand how search engines work.
Can the search engines themselves be held liable for trademark infringement?
Until recently, it appeared the answer was no. Suits against the search engines had generally been unsuccessful. However, very recently, the Fourth Circuit decided a case called Rosetta Stone versus Google. And in that case, the Fourth Circuit reversed the trial court's grant of summary judgment for Google and held that the case presented triable issues of fact as to whether Google committed trademark infringement by selling Rosetta Stone's marks as keywords. So it'll be very interesting to see what happens with this case on remand.
What about the use of keyword advertising to sell counterfeit goods?
Well, counterfeiting on the internet involves a different set of issues, but Google and the other search engines do have policies in place that are supposed to prevent the use of keywords to sell counterfeit goods. So at least in theory, the use of keywords for this purpose is not permitted.
So Matt, should companies be concerned about the use of their trademarks in keyword advertising?
I think at the very least it makes sense for companies to be aware of whether their marks are being used in this way or not. And it's really very simple to check. It's purely a question of going on to each search engine, typing in the company name or other trademark, and seeing what sponsored links appear. And at that point, depending on the facts and circumstances of the use, in-house counsel can make a determination as to whether to take action or not.
That brings us to the end of this episode of Studio CF. We hope you found this discussion informative. Please take a moment to browse our other legal topics and be sure to check back with us each month for new episodes. Thank you for watching.